So thank you everyone for joining us. I am so excited to welcome you to our inaugural event of Breaking Bread in McLean County, a series that is dedicated to the immigrant experience and their stories. It's a 10-part series. This is our first night. It will go through November. And we are partners with, of course, the McLean County Museum of History, Be In Welcoming, a coalition of the Immigration Project, Not In Our Town, Not In Our Schools, West Bloomington Revitalization Project, the Mennonite Church of Normal, and First United Methodist Church Together, creating environment for immigrants to McLean County. And finally, a big shout out to Design Streak at Illinois State University for their amazing graphics and support. When I joined the conversation with these community groups about organizing a series on the topic of immigration in McLean County, I reflected on the push and pull of the immigrant experience, and I became familiar with that terminology when I read Wilkerson's amazing The Warmth of Other Suns. What pushes people to leave their homes and what pulls them into new and often very strange lands? What kinds of relationships are forged in these spaces and what tensions arise? We will be exploring these and other questions in the context of food, hence breaking bread, as a metaphor of a common staple we share across cultures, while also recognizing important and distinct variation. So this evening, I am delighted to present It's All in the Salsa, Mexican-American Stories of McLean County. And when I worked with teachers in Bakersfield and Delano, California, I had the lovely experience of getting to know a lot of immigrant families and students and their stories. And we would come together and share and break bread, and it was amazing food. The program will be presented by Carolyn Nadeau, who's the Byron S. Tucci Professor of Hispanic Studies at Illinois Wesleyan University, and Constantina Navarrete, the owner of Taqueria El Porton in Bloomington. To your health, and take it away, Carolyn.
Thank you so much, Julie, for your introduction. And really, thank you for hosting this. And again, I want to reiterate your thanks to the McLean County Museum of History, to the BN Welcoming, and all of the groups that make that up. I also want to particularly thank Hannah Johnson and also archivist Bill Kemp for providing access to wonderful artifacts in the museum, and to Dave Hurst, who first turned me on to this exciting Breaking Bread series. So I also want to recognize, and now I'll start sharing my, I made a little PowerPoint here to share with you all tonight in introducing our person that we're going to be interviewing, Constantina Navarrete. I also want to recognize the tremendous research of a group of dedicated scholars and citizens who several years ago were involved in the Latino History Project. And I'm just going to open this up for a minute to show you all this amazing resource we have in our community here. The information that they have collected and archived and shared has provided much of the context for my own introduction this evening. In the online section here under programs and lectures, you can see some of the fascinating talks that have been given, but I really want to draw your attention to Dreams and Life on the Prairie. And it is really this group of people here that have offered rich details of life of Latinos throughout McLean County's history. These five individuals have been fundamental to preserving Latino history in our community today. And I'm going to be quoting some of them in my talk. So to contextualize, and I'll go back here to the PowerPoint, the beginning of Latino migration in McLean County, we must frame their story within the larger narrative taking place in the last part of the 19th century when Mexican immigrants were instrumental to laying the railroad in the United States. And that wave of labor brought Mexican immigrants to Illinois. One source records that the Mexican population represented 43% of the total labor force of the railroads in the United States. So it is, in fact, around 1870 is when we have the first record of Latinos in McLean County. And here we have documentations of Latinos working the railroads, like, and I'll just pull up this one record, census record from 1880. And you'll see here Francis Anthony, right? And Francis Anthony lived on Seminary Avenue and recorded in this 1880 census that he, and you'll see here, let's see where my little, works in the railroad shop. And he is a Spanish speaker, the first Spanish speaking resident that's recorded in the census here. So a couple of issues to keep in mind with the migration flow from Mexico to the US is first the Mexican Revolution of 1910 and its aftermath in the Mexican countryside, where it really became a place of economic, political, and social insecurity. But it is at the same time that the American industry and countryside needed to supply workers who had marched off to World War I. So in this way, Mexican migrants solved the problem of security and work in their own communities in Mexico, and the United States obtained a strong labor force as a result. The government legalized these flows in 1917 by establishing a special program to temporarily admit Mexican labor, and that program ended in 1921. And I wanted to show you here a registration card we have from Jesus Flores, right? And you'll see this is dated over in June 1917. And this is a, he notes here that he's a railroad laborer as well. Mark Wyman, one of the group of five in the history project I mentioned earlier, confirms, and I'll quote him, "Without doubt, the railroad was the major reason for the initial entry of Mexicans into the county in the 1920s. So we see proof of that type of labor in Bloomington-Normal via the census data. And here I'll just pull up another one. This is from 1920, and you'll see this highlighted part here. You see how they're laid out here. The recorder writes Mexican for all of these people. And this is Joe Garcia's family, who lived on the CNA track. So they are actually living, you know, in the railroad, lived on the CNA track in Bloomington and worked as a laborer for the railroad. And he recorded that he and his wife, his son, where's my little cursor here, and his one of his two daughters had moved to Bloomington Normal 4 years prior from Mexico, and that their youngest daughter was born here in Illinois. I'll note here that there's over a dozen other Mexicans who also reside in one railroad right-of-way bunk car. All are listed as roomers, and there's a whole series of names there. And I'll say as a side note that at this time, the Chicago-Alton line outsourced its housing to the Lewis Citro Company. And the Lewis Citro Company was responsible for building labor camps. And I'll quote here, in order to handle the feeding and housing of all the foreign transient laborers who worked in the storeroom and on the section of the Chicago and Alton. That's from, and we'll see this now, we'll see it in a minute, the newspaper article that they came from in 1927. So listed among them is Francisca Sanopos. And this is a little harder to see, but here is Sanopos Francisca. And I mention her because she is, where do we see this? Oh, hold on a second. She is listed as a cook for the bunk cars. And she, together with another woman, Amy Owens, also listed as a cook for the bunk cars. Francisca is the first documentation of a Mexican immigrant working in the food service industry here in McLean County. So this is the article that I was referencing before, and it's in Bloomington's Daily Bulletin, writes about these accommodations, and it says, and I'll quote, and it says in here that the commissary building, there's a kitchen, a dining room, and stores department, and the stores department's like a little convenient shop to buy things. The kitchen is equipped with two large hotel ranges of the coal burning variety, one of which has an oven large enough to bake 20 loaves of bread at one time. The chefs who work in the Citro camps are all specially trained for company work. At the local camp, there is a chef and one assistant. And this article also states that the commissary building had been erected 7 years prior. So that for me, drawing from the 1920 census and this 7 years later article, would seem to indicate that the most likely that Francisca and Amy were the inaugural cooks in that commissary. Mexican migrants were making their lives here in McLean County, but some of them also had their lives cut short on the rails. And such is the case with Bernabe Sandoval, 35, of San Jose, Mexico, who died from injuries sustained when he fell under the Chicago Alton train when he attempted to board at the Washington Street crossing. That's from 1925. Immigrants from Latin America and their families continue to maintain ties with the railroad, as we see evidence here in 1987 newspaper article on a group of Latino men who were based in Bloomington, but would travel around the Midwest to work on the railroad. Waves of immigrants, it's no surprise, generally coincide with the economic of this country. With the Great Depression, there was a decline and more than half a million Mexican and Mexican Americans were deported. And with World War II, Mexican immigrants were warmly welcomed once again, and an increase in migration begins. So before moving into the second part of the 20th century, I'll just note two other points of interest here. And first, that there are data on several others who primarily worked for the railroad from the late 19th century through the 1930s in the county records. And there are also listed there Mexicans who are working as servants in private homes, like Erlindo Martinez and Gertrude Gertrude Newberry. Her father, of course, was not Mexican, but she was born in Mexico and her mother as well. They were both servants in private homes over on Washington Street and Olive Street. Another was a clothes cleaner, and then the majority of them, as I said, worked in the railroad. But second, and in addition to the railroad, the Mexican labor force was essential to the agricultural successes in the Midwest. This labor force cleared land, sowed, watered, and harvested agricultural products, and in 1929 came to represent 40% of all the fruits and vegetables grown in the United States. The majority of the immigrants were in agriculture, and primarily in the Southwest, but also in the Midwest as well. So that kind of brings us up into the 1940s and with the creation of the Bracero program in 1942, which lasted until 64. 4.8 million Mexicans enrolled in what was officially called the Mexican Farm Labor Supply Program, which definitively served the interests of American corporation and the American government. This program reached an annual peak in the late 50s with 440,000 Mexican migrant workers coming in 1957-58, forming a constant supply of cheap labor for the agribusiness. Although the program stipulates that braceros are entitled to certain provisions, including equal wages to native workers, free housing, affordable meals, and insurance, these rules were broken by many employers. The conditions were harsh. Workers endured prejudice, substandard housing, physical mistreatment, exposure to pesticides, and inadequate medical care. Wages were commonly withheld, and often hours were not counted. We do have in this Bracero History Archive oral histories, including some who worked here in Illinois, like Gregorio Trejo, who described how one of his co-workers passed away while working in the cornfields of Illinois, and how the farmers behaved both during and after that tragic accident. And locally, Sal Valadez, again, lead researcher of the McLean County Museum of History's Latino History Project, discusses how his father and his grandfather both came through this program and that it provided a lifeline to his family and so many other Mexican families that confronted poverty at its deepest levels in their home country. And that despite these harsh conditions, the Bracero program provided them a way forward. At the close of the Bracero program, and we'll just quickly open this link up, the last of the directors of the Bracero program that worked out of the Department of Labor referred to it as a system of legalized slavery. So that gives you a sense of the harsh realities that immigrants endured through that. There's also some local reporting that's happening at this time on Latinos in McLean County in the 50s and 60s, but I will say the articles are few and scattered. But there is one here on the Cuban refugee program of 1962 that brought Cuban families here to McLean County. And so we see this one article, Quiet, Peaceful, Cubans Call the Bloomington Refuge. The mayor at the time created a 14-person committee that was involved in bringing Cubans to our community. So in recent history and up till today, when that Bracero program ended, the following year, or in 1965, Congress voted in the Immigration Reform Act, which for the first time set hemispheric limits on the numbers of immigrants, and in turn, for the first time, set limits on the number of Mexicans that could immigrate to the United States. Another significant act occurs in the mid-80s with Immigration Reform and Control Act. This is when essentially the United States offers amnesty to 3.7 undocumented immigrants, of which about 70%, 2.6 million, accept, and the overwhelming majority of those who accepted that those who are naturalized were Mexicans. We have reports here in McLean County on the amnesty program. There's in 1987, 1988, a series of several articles like this one that talk about the permanency offered, 80 farm workers seeking legal residence, pursuing the American dream, and that sort of thing. And I'll say too, in the 80s, we begin to see in the media here an increase in human interest stories in the local press. So things like the Guadalupe Day Parade or the Quinceañeras, or there's an article profiling sisters missing their homeland, or a beautiful article on a program Illinois State designed that hosted 200 migrant children to help deliver some academic educational programming for them, because they so often, when their parents would move for harvesting and planting and other work, they would be pulled out of school. So ISU offered that program to them over a couple of years in the early 80s. We also in the 80s begin to get articles and advertisements for local Mexican and Caribbean restaurants. So here in a 1980 article, owner of the Mexican Border Cantina, which my understanding was it was like a pickup place, not a sit-down restaurant. His name was William Robinson, and I'll quote him in this article you see on the left, Normal Restaurant Serves Mexican Food. He says, "Mexican food is going to be the food of the 80s. People are getting tired of hamburgers. You'll find a full service Mexican sit-down restaurant in Bloomington-Normal in the next year or so." And over here on the left, this article on Mexican eatery seeks liquor license indeed is for Nuevo Chim's Caribbean and Mexican cuisine, a restaurant that was originally in Danvers, and they were planning to move to Bloomington and so sought a liquor license for a 70-seat restaurant they had on Prospect Road. There's another one too for out of Clinton. Clinton had a restaurant, Soto's Place. Amalia Soto Gent was the owner for almost 20 years, 18 and a half years. It was a popular Mexican restaurant in Clinton that closed in 2013. Moving closer into the 1990s, we get a sense of changes in the community by the coverage in the Pantograph, when articles are now covering more of the challenges for immigrants here. There's reports of violence and prejudice. There's arrest of illegal aliens, raids and deportations. But at the same time, there are rallies against racism and racial injustice. There are calls for inclusivity, acknowledgement of language and cultural barriers. There's the community healthcare clinic opens in the 90s, providing access to uninsured residents in the area. And then I just want to show here a little bit to get a sense of the numbers of immigrants coming in, primarily from Mexico, but we'll see that it changes a little bit as we enter into the 21st century. So in the mid 80s, we have in the Pantograph a citation of 500 Mexican American restaurants. Census data shows in the 90s, 1600, that doubles by 2000. In 2010, it doubles once again. I will say though, in conversations over at Western Avenue that people think that these are modest reports of census data and that the local population is probably much, much more than that. In the 2000s, entering the 21st century, continued protest, rallies, forums on immigration laws and reform continue. And too often we have to protest basic human rights of undocumented individuals living in our community. However, we also begin to see an uptick in resources available to immigrants from Latin America and Spanish-speaking residents in the form of grassroots organizations like Latinos Unidos and Hispanic Families Work Group that then morphed into Conexiones Latinas, which continues today. There exists in the early 2000s two talk show radio programs in Spanish, one Spanish newspaper, increased library programming in Spanish, and an increased consciousness of the value of immigrants to the Bloomington-Normal community. So with this greater awareness of contributions also comes increase in local business. And here I'll highlight a few of the restaurants before we move into the featured interview of this evening's program. We see here one of the early takeout menus for El Porton. Also Fiesta Ranchera has two or three restaurants here locally. The Carniceria La Mexicana is still here today as a supermarket. And here's another one, some of you may not remember. Mi Tierra was another local market right in downtown Bloomington that was here for several years before it closed. So it's really within this framework that the Navarretes entered McLean County in 2002. In this interview with co-owner of La Taqueria El Porton, Constantina Navarrete, co-owner with her husband, Adolfo, we'll hear the challenges of migratory movement, of nonstop hard work, and the challenges of starting a small business, of getting bank loans and backers, of juggling jobs and raising children, and yes, especially of being a small business owner while trying to raise a family. In this interview, listen to what it is like to live in another country and have family far away. Consider the sacrifices of missing celebrations together or grieving when a family member passes. How do migrants preserve traditions while adapting and assimilating to the new culture and environment at the same time? Constantina and Adolfo have lived these challenges, but at the same time have grown their restaurant into a successful business in the Bloomington-Normal community. For these past 20 years, they've shared with others their rich gastronomic heritage and opened their doors to all. In the second part of the interview, the conversation shifts to the differences between Hispanic and Anglo eating habits in the Mexican restaurant. We'll hear about what was, for me, the unexpected transmigration impact of Mexican food eaten in America on the Mexican food eaten in Mexico. The dual influences of those who travel between and live among two cultures. And finally, as you listen, consider your own story or that of a neighbor or a friend. How does Constantina's journey resonate with your own? How does it differ? Who sits at your table? And how have your food experiences defined your identity, your profession, or your personal relations? Okay, let's see, I'm gonna move out of this and go into the interview. And I think I have that right. Okay, so here we go, our interview with Constantina, and this is about a 20-minute interview. We'll hear Constantina tell her life, and then we'll return for question and answer and discussion.
Buenos días.
Hola, buenos días.
Estamos aquí con Constantina Navarrete, la propietaria de la Taqueria El Porton, que va a compartir con nosotros hoy, soy Carolyn Nadeau, profesora de la Universidad de Illinois Wesleyan University. Y vamos a hablar un poco hoy para la serie de Breaking Bread con Constantina sobre su juventud en México, sobre su pasaje a Estados Unidos y luego a Bloomington, y sobre un poco la Taquería El Portón y lo que su relación aquí con la comunidad y lo que aporta a la comunidad. Así que buenos días.
Hola, buenos días.
Entonces, por favor, Constantina, cuéntenos un poco de dónde es usted, de qué parte de México y unos recuerdos de su juventud.
Pues mi juventud fue crecer en un rancho muy pobre, fui muy pobre, trabajaba ayudando a mi papá a sembrar en el campo. Mi papá sembraba maíz, frijol, calabaza, y esa fue mi juventud. Crecí y toda la gente pobre allá tenía el sueño de venirse a superar a Estados Unidos. Mi papá casi no me dejó estudiar porque pues nos ponía a trabajar bien duro. Nos vinimos crecí, me casé en el 1987, y llegué con mi esposo, trabajamos piscando fresa. Y en Florida, y luego fuimos a Nueva York a piscar fresa, y ahí piscábamos de todo, calabacita, pepino, bell pepper, fresa, chile, tomate.
Wow.
Y después vinimos aquí a Illinois. Empezamos a trabajar en una compañía de...
¿Cuándo llegaron a Illinois?
Llegamos como el 88.
O sea, como un año pasando de Florida, Nueva York, otras partes.
Sí, fue después de un año llegamos aquí.
Yeah.
Entramos a trabajar a una fábrica que se llamaba Bristol Division.
Mm.
Era de hongo, mushroom.
Ah.
Trabajamos 10 años ahí y empezó a nacer la idea de que mi cuñado decía que mi esposo y yo cocinábamos rico. Dice, ustedes deberían ponerse un restaurante. Pero pues veíamos difícil de hacerlo porque pues no teníamos el dinero para empezar, ni el estudio, porque nos pedían clases de...
Ah, sí.
De cocinar, algo así. Entonces, seguimos buscando y nos gustaba aquí Bloomington porque no había muchos restaurantes mexicanos. Mexicano.
Sí.
Entonces, empezamos a mi cuñado nos ayudó con una parte de dinero. Y nosotros empezamos a conseguir, tenía mis tres niños chicos todavía.
¿Cuántos años tenían en aquella época?
Mi hija tenía como 9 años y el más grande tenía como 13.
Okay.
Entonces empezamos, fue muy difícil porque con los niños chiquitos para llevarlos a inscribir a la escuela, las citas del doctor y todo eso, vivíamos en Perú, Illinois.
Ah, okay.
Y este es una hora.
Sí.
Empezamos a abrir aquí en abrimos el 2002 en agosto del 2002 y este íbamos y veníamos todos los días una hora hasta Perú. Llegábamos ya tarde, bañaba a los niños y en la mañana otra vez para ponerlos a la escuela aquí para tenerlos cerca.
Ay, ay, ay.
Y este.
Entonces asistían a la escuela en Bloomington.
Ajá.
Ah, ¿a Bent? ¿Por caso?
Fueron a Bent.
Ah.
Ajá. Me movían de un lado para otro porque yo todavía no tenía bien dónde vivir aquí.
Ay, 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 ay.
Este, de principio conseguí una dirección con unos amigos.
Sí.
Y después la escuela no aceptó.
Ay, ay, ay.
Entonces tuvimos que rentar y pagar la renta, el pago de la casa allá en Perú.
Entonces tenían casa en Perú y también
renta acá.
Oh, wow.
Ya después por fin se vendió la casa y rentamos una casa aquí.
Yeah.
Y como nos movimos para Normal, tuvimos que cambiar los niños de escuela. Y era una movedera. Era algo que no nos poníamos fijamente. Sí. Después empezaron adolescentes, yo aquí y ellos hacían por allá lo que querían a mis espaldas.
Yeah.
Yo sentía que el mundo se me venía encima.
Ah.
Porque
claro.
No era fácil dejar el negocio a cuidado de alguien más porque no te lo van a cuidar como,
exacto,
como es. Yeah. Yo miraba.
Yeah,
entonces
tenías que estar aquí todo el día, pero cuidar a los niños.
No podíamos emplear mucha gente, o sea, yo no podía emplear otra gente porque no entraba suficiente dinero.
Sí.
Pues yo tenía que estar.
Sí.
Y mi esposo también trabajando atrás en la cocina, o sea, los dos trabajamos muy duro para permanecer, porque no fue fácil, pensábamos que no íbamos a estar muy ocupados, pensábamos que cuando nosotros entramos aquí teníamos otro trabajo en Buenona de la galletería.
Ah.
Ya trabajábamos ahí en la galleta de Buenona y trabajábamos de noche, tercer turno.
Wow.
Y yo decía, no voy a cuitear, nos agarramos vacaciones, dijimos, de día vamos a trabajar al restaurante y en la noche en las galletas.
Wow.
Y pues obvio teníamos quien nos cuidara a los niños así. Entonces pues pagaba Bay City. Y se acabaron mis vacaciones para regresar a las galletas y miré que ya no podía. Porque sí teníamos bastante clientela.
Ah, qué bien.
Entonces pues decidimos dejar el trabajo a las galletas y dedicarnos aquí. Y y así. Fueron pasando los años, no puedo creer que ya llevemos 18 años aquí, en este lugarcito que nos ha dado para sobrevivir, para sacar mis hijos adelante. Ellos crecieron, no quisieron seguir estudiando, ahora ellos ya son independientes. ¿Y
¿Y algunos de los hijos han seguido en el campo de comida, restaurante?
No.
Han buscado su vida.
Han hecho otros trabajos.
Sí.
Mi hija es la que sigue ayudándome aquí, pero más como en lo de la tecnología.
Ah, sí.
Y ella cobra y porque pues nosotros, mi esposo y yo no sabemos mucho de la nueva tecnología.
Ya. Yeah.
Entonces, el inglés no es muy perfecto de nosotros, le batallamos también. Yo siempre ocupaba a mis hijos que me ayudaran. Y mi hija es la que más se ha integrado a ayudarme, más responsable.
Sí, sí.
Ya tiene sus 28 años, ya tiene que ser más responsable.
Sí.
Y así ha sido mi tiempo de sobrevivir.
Hubo, no sé, como un año o un momento en esta vida profesional cuando por fin podía como respirar y decir, ok, estamos bien, no tengo que preocuparme como antes.
Sí, cuando mis hijos empezaron a tener sus propios trabajos y como que ya hicieron su familia y aquí seguía bien el negocio, la clientela nos ha apoyado muchísimo.
Sí.
Entonces yo sentí que ya había valido la pena mi esfuerzo, mi sacrificio de cuando empezamos, que batallé con los niños. Y luego ya cuando empecé, me podía ir en diciembre a México a pasar Navidad con mis suegros, porque ellos nunca vinieron. Nosotros los visitábamos a ellos. Entonces,
¿Y sus propios padres?
Mis papás sí venían, sí vinieron los primeros años. Mis papás sí conocieron mi trabajo aquí y todo.
Al restaurante.
Al restaurante, y estaban muy orgullosos.
Iba a decir qué orgullo para ellos.
Sí, estaban muy orgullosos y mi papá falleció hace 15 años, a los 3 años que abrimos aquí, okay. Él falleció. Mi mamá falleció hace 4 años. Y y es por eso que nosotros tratamos de ir a México cada que podemos.
Exacto.
Ahora pues ya me siento más a gusto poder ir, ya se queda mi hija encargada. Y esa es mi satisfacción de haber trabajado tan duro.
Qué bien.
Que ahora ya puedo ir y regresar.
Ya. Bueno, y aún así, usted está aquí todos los días, ¿verdad?
Sí, o sea, ¿no? Yo estoy aquí todos los días para ver qué hace falta, para preparar todo lo que haga falta en la mañana, salsas.
¿Y algún otro guisado? ¿Qué partes le gustan de su trabajo? O sea, ¿es el trabajo de la cocina y preparar la comida o es más bien tratar a los clientes? O...
Los dos es muy satisfactorio, ¿no? Porque así como se trabaja de duro en la cocina, también se trabaja duro con los clientes, porque hay algunos clientes que a veces vienen de mal humor o no son personas muy así que lo hagan sentir bien a uno, ¿verdad? Pero también hay mucha clientela que siempre nos hacen sentir muy bien.
Sí, exacto, sí. Y aquí sirven tanto a gente de habla español como gente de habla inglés, o hay mucho más de habla inglés, o cómo es la mezcla de clientela.
Yo miro que ha habido más clientela americana que hispana. Porque el hispano tiene hasta 2 trabajos y salen como a comer una vez a la semana.
Sí.
Y el americano es diario que salen a comer. Buscan lo más económico del menú, pero vienen más veces a la semana que el hispano.
Sí. Sí.
Pero sí, cuando viene el hispano, consume muy bien, comen, toman. Y el americano, pues... se pide 2 tacos, agua, y el mexicano pide un platillo y cerveza o refresco.
O sea, entonces se nota una diferencia cultural entre qué pide.
Otra cosa que estoy bien feliz es que el americano le ha gustado mucho mis salsas. Y dicen que el americano no come mucho el picante, pero la verdad, aquí comen mucho el picante. Les encanta la salsa.
Sí, ok, qué curioso. Hay platos aquí en El Portón, los más como populares, los que piden más la gente, o hay, piden de todo.
Piden de todo.
De todo,
De todo. Y hemos tratado con placer al americano porque nos pedían como la chimichanga. Ese no es un platillo muy mexicano. Pero es como más Tex-Mex, pero lo hemos agregado. Lo que es eso, el burrito y la quesadilla es también como que lo hemos agregado aquí porque lo piden mucho. Lo piden mucho.
Así que en México no se comían tanto las quesadillas, los burritos.
No.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Pero hoy en día yo veo, como hemos ido a México, sí, ya también allá implementaron el burrito y la quesadilla.
Ah, o sea, uh-huh. Ah, entonces hay... Ah, qué curioso, ¿no?
Sí,
o
porque sea, como mucha gente va para allá,
sí,
pues ya los niños, especialmente cuando llevamos los niños pequeños, luego quieren que la quesadilla.
Ya, yeah, ya.
Yeah. O así, y ya en México han implementado mucho ya el burrito y la quesadilla. Y,
qué curiosa esa transformación, uh-huh. ¿no? De venir, o sea, la influencia de la comida mexicana en Estados Unidos, sí. Y luego la influencia de la comida mexicana, sí. En Estados Unidos. De vuelta, sí.
¿No? Porque hoy en día hay mucho de que como mi familia, mis niños los llevaba casi cada año y pues ellos crecieron gustándoles la comida de allá.
Ay, ay, ay.
Y vienen aquí y les gusta la comida de aquí. Es así como que, y hay mucha familia que se van para Navidad o se van para la fiesta de su pueblo. Entonces hay mucho turismo para allá y para acá. Mm. Mm-hmm. Hoy en día.
Y no sé, ¿hay platos entre su familia, platos más, yo qué sé, favoritos o que comen en ocasiones especiales? O...
Sí, en mi familia el plato favorito que comemos en momentos especiales es el mole.
Ah, oh, el mole.
Ajá, el mole. Aquí lo he hecho algunas veces y se vende muy bien, pero es mucho trabajo para hacer mole.
Ah, ya.
Es lo mismo que hacer los tamales. Ay, se lleva mucho tiempo, mucho esfuerzo. Entonces, sí, allá eso es lo que hacemos en una... fiesta como Año Nuevo, Navidad, hacemos que los tamales, el pollo, el puerco y el mole.
Y cuénteme, el mole, ¿cómo es el plato? O sea, que dice usted que es mucho trabajo y estoy de acuerdo, pero ¿cómo es?
El mole se cocina el pollo, se saca del caldo. Y el caldo muchas personas lo usan para moler chile, porque se lleva chile guajillo, chile ancho, chile pasilla, y lleva muchos ingredientes como el ajo, el comino, la pimienta, el pimentón, ginger, el jengibre,
qué rico.
Lleva poquitas pasas. Lleva muchos ingredientes, poquito de todo, ¿verdad? Hace la salsa muy rica y queda espesa, rojo. Entonces, eso es lo que se lleva mucho tiempo en preparar.
Sí, el mole, ¿tiene cacao?
¿Cacao? No. No. Hay personas que lo hacen dulce porque le ponen chocolate, hasta azúcar.
Yeah.
Pero a mí no me gusta así.
Ah, ok.
A mí me gusta poquito picosito.
Ya. Yeah. Entonces la salsa suya es, la base es más bien los chiles, uh-huh. y las otras especies.
Sí.
Ah, qué curioso.
Y pues se remuele en la licuadora y luego se guisa y luego después se le pone el pollo, la carne. Y ya queda en salsa así muy espesita.
Uy, qué rico.
Está rico.
Entonces esto es más bien como para Navidad,
o Año Nuevo, sí. O una boda.
Sí, una boda, ya, ya.
Una fiesta.
No, entonces hay personas que le piden encargado un mole para una ocasión.
Aquí, llegué a hacer mole en una ocasión para la iglesia de Santa María. Hice mole y también les encantó.
Ya,
también cuando hago los tamales de puerco y pollo,
sí,
les encantan. Eso es como adicional al menú, no lo tengo en el menú.
Ah, ok.
Lo aquí, hago cuando...
Ya, ocasiones.
A ocasiones, así como ahorita diciembre, hago los tamales.
Sí, me hablaba la semana pasada, ¿verdad?
Sí.
¿Para el Día de Acción de Gracias fue?
Hice para antes del Día del Thanksgiving, y ahorita todavía sigo haciendo porque me siguen ordenando.
Yeah.
Y este, ya como para la siguiente semana voy a parar de hacer tamales porque este, me voy también de vacaciones.
Ah, qué bien. Ah,
sí, este.
Muy bien. Bueno, a ver si hay otras cosas. A ver, pensando en todas, o sea, desde su juventud trabajando en el campo y luego la transición a Estados Unidos también, trabajo con la comida y hasta aquí en Illinois. La comida para usted sirvió de base de, yo qué sé, como estabilidad entre tanto cambio o no lo pensó así, no sé.
No lo pensaba.
Yeah.
Yo no lo, nunca me imaginé este, estar trabajando así en nuestro propio negocio.
Mm.
Jamás me lo imaginé, se dio y este, me imagino que gracias a Dios y a mi cuñado que nos escuchó.
Sí, exacto.
Él nos dio la idea y pues sí, en parte apoyo también económico.
Sí, sí, uh-huh, sí, muy importante. Muy bien, pues muchas gracias. No sé si hay otra cosa que usted quiere compartir con nosotros.
Pues creo que no, porque ya hablé mucho.
Muy bien. Bueno, pues hace otra ocasión y muchas gracias.
Okay, gracias.
Okay, adiós.
Adiós.
A mí me gusta el mole, mi soledad me va a moler. A mí me gusta el mole, mi soledad me va a moler.
That was great. Okay. I love the music. Now I want to eat mole. So, oh yeah, people are wanting the recipe. So an earlier question that came up during the presentation is if there are any family members of the original Cuban immigrants still living in McLean County. And I don't know if you came across that in your research, Carolyn, but I thought I'd ask.
Well, there certainly are, but not because I found information in the archives, and I wasn't looking for that, but through, you know, friends of friends that I know that are Cuban immigrants here, and so their families are still here, yes.
Yeah, that makes sense. And we also had a question about the mushroom factory. Princeton Farms in Depew, is it, and it's a massive operation. Is it the mushroom factory in Princeton Farms? Is that where you worked, Constantina?
It was mushrooms, but it's on a Princeton division. Company, this is Yesenia, her daughter, responding for her real quick. The actual company's name is Monterey Mushroom.
Oh, sure.
And then it's in Princeton, Illinois.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
You're welcome.
We definitely have a lot of requests for the recipe. Would it be okay for us to share it?
Que si les das permiso de compartir su receta. Sure.
Thank you. What do you think is the best way for someone to learn Spanish in this community?
¿Cuál es el mejor modo de que alguien aprenda español en esta comunidad? Viendo telenovelas. Yesenia aprendió viendo la tele en español.
So I'll translate for her. Uh-huh. What she's saying is that
One way I learned best was watching telenovelas on yeah, or just like practicing just with them. Like they made us always talk to them in Spanish instead of English. What she would also like recommend is just practice with whoever speaks it. And nowadays we have really good apps.
Yes, I've heard that. I wish somebody said, I wish I'd taken Spanish instead of French in high school. I agree. I spent a little bit of time at one CSI language school in Guatemala, in Xela. And the whole point was really to learn about that culture, because so many of my students came from Central America when I worked in Massachusetts. And it was for sure the best way to learn is just to immerse yourself in the language.
Can I also add before we move on to another question?
Please.
Any people with influence in the audience, the best way to learn Spanish is to start offering it in elementary school.
Yes.
If kindergartners learning a second language, that would be terrific.
Two-way immersion, right? Bilingual education done right. Let's see. So this is a question for Constantina and her family. How is transitioning and growing up in a predominantly white town? And what effects did it have on you and your children growing up here, trying to keep your culture strong and maintain your traditions? If that makes sense.
So la pregunta es para nosotros como familia y para ti, cómo te sentiste o cómo fue creciendo vivir en una comunidad tan americana, cómo le hiciste para mantener tus rutas mexicanas. So I translated it for her, but me as her daughter, I would say because I was the youngest. Because I was the youngest, I can say, you know, it was very difficult because you'd see them try so hard to make sure that we didn't lose our roots. So Spanish in the household, every chance they had to save money to take us to Mexico, they emerged us, you know, like made sure we like stayed within our roots. But it was really easy for us to just like, I can't think of the word, sway away from our roots. It was really easy for us to adapt our American ways because that's all we were, you know, surrounded by, and especially up in La Salle, Peru. But luckily, because of how big the immigrant population was up there, we did get to meet a lot of Hispanics. And so instead of like going to parties with all like Americans, we'd go with all the Mexicans. And like, they mostly try to do that for us. But every now and then, of course, because of school, they also, you know, encouraged us to participate in what school activities we had before the restaurant. After the restaurant, it was really difficult. After the restaurant, we kind of educated ourselves. We kind of taught ourselves that what they showed us, how they educated us to stick to our roots was really important to like follow, because it was really hard to like still like immerse ourselves in it. Even though, you know, we were always at the restaurant helping with whatever we could, a lot of the times we weren't. And we weren't together as a family. So we had to kind of do it ourselves. And now as adults, we definitely encourage education and knowledge of our culture and our roots, because it's quite amazing what the Hispanic community is. Like their culture is just so rich.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope that answered the question.
Oh, it was a great answer.
Okay.
Would you say that there's any difference between how American customers respond to you and the staff versus the Mexican community?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. How can I say it? There's just like a variety. Thankfully, we've, you know, been seen how like how accepting this community is, Bloomington-Normal, is of us Hispanics, and they've responded to our restaurant, since our restaurant is a little bit more authentic. It's not as Tex-Mex.
Right.
We get a lot of customers that are like, oh wait, that's not what I thought was Mexican food, and we're just like, well,
this is actually Mexican food.
Yeah, it's like, let me just educate you a little bit on how you stereotype our food, and just so whenever we can, we give them a little bit of education on the difference of Tex-Mex and actual authentic Mexican.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where is your mom from in Mexico?
So the state is the state of Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's like South Central. The little town is called Palmar Chico.
Palmar Chico?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Estado de Mexico, so state of Mexico.
I see. Great.
So they're like 4 hours away from Mexico City.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. I think I've got. What food would your Mexican American clients consider your best comfort food?
Anything covered in cheese sauce.
Well, that's ubiquitous.
Yeah. I'm trying to think, but yeah, mostly they go with tacos or like burritos or quesadillas.
And how's the restaurant managed during the pandemic?
We've actually been really lucky. We've been doing pretty good, pretty consistent.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, we've had a pretty awesome outreach from our community, and they've really made sure that we stayed in business.
That's good.
Yeah.
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 Well, I love coming to your restaurant. So
thank you.
I will come again soon. I'm looking at the chat to see if there are any lingering questions, and I think I've gotten them all. I love the interview. Thank you so much for sharing. Ah. Oh, were you, I do have another question I can ask. Were you aware of or mixed with migrant workers that worked in Princeville?
One more time, what was the question?
Were you aware of migrant workers who worked in Princeville?
Yes, si tú sabes de los trabajadores migrantes que trabajan por allá en esas áreas.
Well, I think not exactly 100% aware of all the migrant workers, but they also did help in the strawberry fields up in Hennepin. So I'm sure that there was moments where they saw the migrant forces all around Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
And up in that small valley of Spring Valley.
Here's another question. Do many Mexicans from your local community attend Illinois State University? And if so, what do they say about that experience?
Okay, one more time. What was the question?
Sure. Do many Mexicans from your local community attend Illinois State University? And if so, what was their experience going to school at ISU?
ISU has now created a, I think it's a sorority and a fraternity kind of mixed together of just Latinos, which I think it's great. I've only seen them emerge in like the last 5 or so years.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of other Hispanics or Latinos usually attend more Heartland because of, you know, financial reasons. Mm-hmm. But if we do get a hold of, you know, students and we talk to them and we ask them, they usually say that their experience here is pretty great. They like it versus other schools or other towns because they are, most of them do come from Chicago as well.
Mm-hmm.
That we ask, and it's like funny to us that they leave Chicago to come to Bloomington.
Yes.
But so that they can concentrate on their education, which they believe is very important. Mm-hmm. They do it. So it's you get a lot of good feedback on that too.
Is there anything else you would like to add? I do have a question. If you can tell us where you worked in Florida. It's busy.
Plain City.
I feel like we're
Plain City.
Okay. And how do you? This is a great question to end it. How do you keep your avocados so fresh?
The secret is we buy them very green, so really hard.
Right.
And we keep them in a warm area of the restaurant, covered in a blanket, so that they can mature. And then usually that's when we usually use them. And we try to keep them in like the right temperature just to make sure that they don't get over matured. So it's a science.
It's a science, no kidding. I need to be educated. But that's interesting because I find if I do buy really unripe avocados and let them do their thing, then when I choose to use them, they're perfect.
Yeah. that's really the secret, is find them when they're still green, like very unmature, really hard, and just letting them soften up and use them at the right moment.
Right. Great. Another question just popped up. People are like coming up with great ideas. The avocados question was a little bit easier than this one, but would you be willing to comment a little bit about the Mexican community in Bloomington and ICE and immigration authorities?
2019.
Did you hear me?
Yeah, I heard you. So la pregunta es que ¿cómo sientes que la comunidad responde a inmigración aquí en esta comunidad? So for my mom, she says that for her, because of how overwhelming work can be and how busy she can be, she doesn't really pay attention to ICE or what immigration is doing. But I like to talk to the community a little bit more, kind of just to see, you know, their side of things. And I've heard them, you know, a little bit of a mixture. It's scary, really. Mm-hmm. I've had, close people that I've seen that, you know, they've endured the hardship of losing one parent, and it was just difficult for them to be able to picture life without their parents and being, you know, having to figure things out on their own and just, you know, being completely torn apart by ICE, you know. Yeah, it's, you know, wrong that they came into the United States undocumented and lived illegally, but they're not criminals. They're not doing anything wrong by working. So being taken away so violently and just like torn from their families, it's a hard topic to talk about. Like, it's very emotional and just like, I get a lot of different perspectives on it.
Thank you so much for sharing that.
Thank you.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Yeah.
You are an amazing family. You inspire me, and I can't say enough good things about your program and learning from you this evening. Carolyn, do you want to add anything in closing?
No, only to reiterate what you said. I feel very honored to have been able to interview Constantina. I loved learning about your journey and your migrant story. And thank you so much for all that you do for this community.
Yeah, you're amazing. When I grow up, I want to be like you. this has been a wonderful evening. Thanks to everyone for staying with us, despite our minor technical difficulties, but we figured it out. And I do want to say that we are excited to have our next program, the second installment of the Breaking Bread series, is going to be Saturday, March 13th at 1 p.m. It's called Johnny Cakes to Patty Cakes, Irish Cookery, hosted by our very own Greg Coos, the McLean County Museum of History Executive Director Emeritus. So you'll be getting a lot more information about that. And yes, we will certainly make sure that you have access to this wonderful recipe for mole. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Have a lovely evening.
Thanks, Constantina.
Thank you. Have a good night.